The child who is not embraced by the village will burn it down to feel its warmth. Since the beginning, the prospect of fire has lured many to its radiant glow. Capable of both bright, radiant joy and ash-filled sorrow, this force born from heat and ferocity has enveloped the minds, bodies, and souls of many throughout the passage of time, staining pasts pitch black and birthing futures pure white. Between this line of black and white stand the composite forces of yin and yang. Led by their example, great warriors embodying these concepts pave the way to what they deem as peace. Whether that peace is for their sake or for the sake of others, though, is an entirely different question altogether. The Kung Fu Panda Trilogy is one of DreamWorks Studio's most beloved creations. From the moment of its inception, it was intended by all who put their foot forward with it to be an albeit idolized love letter to the prospects that make China such a compelling and alluring construct within both the modern and ancient world, representing it with the most intended soul, utilizing the art of animation to the absolute fullest. A defining trait of this trilogy is the philosophy it bears in regards to design. Ranging from striking characters to stunning backgrounds, this critical sense of design is what ties together this universe and what makes it as compelling and as well regarded as it is. A core ideal of this philosophy is the constant comparison and importance of the dualizing tones of black and white and the concepts they embody. Being the color scheme of the franchise's lead, it is innately necessary in understanding the construct of this universe and the characters who oppose our hero. The leading example of this philosophy is the antagonist of the second installment, and my personal favorite character in the franchise, Lord Shen, perfectly embodied by the masterful performance of Gary Oldman. Shen, in every way imaginable, stands as the perfect antithesis to Po and every detrimental component that makes up his being. While Shen definitely has interesting character construction and intriguing thematic dualities as leading factors in his makeup, far and beyond, the aspect that sells everything he represents is how seamlessly he fits into the established constructs of the design philosophy that leads these films, and how said philosophy both embodies his character and extends the effect of almost all major characters who interact with him within the established world. Two warriors, both cloaked in black and both cloaked in white, both adored by their parents and abandoned by said same parents, both determined by fire, one who had their past consumed by it and one with their future decided by it, both nothing more than those searching for peace and identity within their lives.
Long ago, in ancient China, the peacocks ruled over Gongmen's city. They brought great joy and prosperity to the city, for they had invented fireworks. But their son, Lord Shen, saw darker power in the fireworks. What had brought color and joy could also bring darkness and destruction. Shen's troubled parents consulted a soothsayer. She foretold that if Shen continued down this dark path, he would be defeated by a warrior of black and white. The young lord set out to change his fate, but what he did next only sealed it. Shen returned to his parents full of pride, but in their faces, he saw only horror. He was banished from the city forever, but Shen swore revenge. Someday, he would return, and all of China would bow at his feet.
Kung Fu Panda 2, from its very first moment, is a story of tragedy and subversion. As opposed to many tales of legendary warriors with the weight of the world blowing at their back, this story finds its inception through the revealing of its villain and the events that determined their existence. Although they didn't make it into the final product, original concepts for the film bluntly reveal major information towards gaining a more complete understanding for the intended composition of what makes Lord Shen, posing interesting questions as to what potentially drives him to his deadly conclusions. Although they are no longer as blunt, these concepts are still supported by other visual and emotional cues within the completed story. Originally, Shen was born a very sickly child, who was most often cared for by the soothsayer, who at the time stood as his caretaker. Having his body decided by Lucism and the concept of death, said tone of white represents within the culture of China. His parents, however, due to their positions of royalty, were all too often unable to attend to his sickness, leaving their son helpless, lonesome, and lost. Due to these circumstances, Shen convinced himself that although he was aware his parents did probably truly love him, that despite their love for him, he was never going to be anything close to a driving priority in their mind, developing his innate desperation to constantly prove he was neither weak nor helpless in order to gain some sense of priority and control of his constantly handed upon circumstances. Later on, as is mirrored by the current film, his parents developed their signature fireworks. Pushed by this, Shen tried to prove himself in both their eyes and his by inventing weaponized gunpowder, building upon their proud achievement, attempting to showcase to the entirety of China that he was in fact not weak nor helpless, but instead both brilliant and strong. Having this in mind recontextualizes Shen massively, and while it obviously doesn't excuse or condone his actions, it certainly gives a logical explanation for the emotion he felt behind them. Shen, all of his life, was discarded, pushed to the side as a constant second. While he knew that people, especially his parents, loved him, that exactly is what drove him as far as it did. In his eyes, exactly because he was so loved, he was so constantly hurt by not having their precedence, so constantly hurt by the fact he was cursed with his white feathers of death, why he was so hurt and focused on proving his lack of weakness, and why he was so desperate to fight against his constantly foretold destinies. His entire life was one that he lived as one thrust upon him, so when he went and struck back against the pandas he was foretold to fall to, he did it out of nothing but the utmost desperation to gain a single last ounce of control for his circumstances in the sea he called life. The one chance he had to strike back against his destiny and to prove that he had a semblance of power to the entire world. When he returned home, filled with pride in response to this achievement, the single thing he yearned for was an inkling of the same pride to be also felt by the parents he had been desperate to reach for so long. Not because he had committed genocide against a species of creatures, but pride for the simple fact that for one of the first times in his life, he was capable enough to counter and avert the fate he had shoved upon him by the universe. But the opposite was the complete and undeniable truth. When Shen's parents gazed upon him, pride was the furthest thing from their mind. All they saw was a hateful, bitter man who had taken the world away from so many for his own selfish, explosive desires. Though due to their constant love for him, even if they didn't showcase it consistently throughout his life, they gave him the final mercy of simple exile instead of execution. To Shen, though, this was the last expression of how they truly felt for him. When Shen enacted work with his parents' beloved fireworks, they feared him. When he attempted to slay his foretold death and destiny, they banished him. When he came to his parents looking for pride and love, despite their adoration and love for him, they chose the world instead of him and abandoned him. On the opposite end of the spectrum, as Shen's life was led by alluring fire, Po's began with it. Through Shen's crusade against the pandas, Po was taken by his mother as far as she could get, till the point there was nowhere else to run. With no other decision before her, she made the heartbreaking decision to abandon her son, while she ran off to be vanquished by Shen and his army. This sense of abandonment is one of the most defining and linking factors between these two men. Having this reveal of both Po and Shen's pasts be united by their showcases in 2D is nothing short of a brilliant decision. Revealing these recollections of what made their histories in said 2D animation, proceeding to sharply return to 3D animation like the rest of the film, once control of these recollections is gained, extols the fact so eloquently of how truly abstract and elusive these connections to their pasts are, to the point that they cannot even be placed within the realms or animation constructs of the accepted reality of the film. This is further supplemented by both of these backstories being cloaked in the bright reds that in the context of the trilogy represent the concept of control, contrasting against the blues representing power and greens representing wisdom of the land the pandas called home, being overtaken by this overbearing red in the first half, then being switched in the second core of the film, tying into the ideologies of these colliding concepts preached by both Oogway and Shifu and enacted by Tai Lung in the first film. Towards the gates of an almighty castle walks a single white envoy, walking with his hands out of sight, surrounded by the red sky matching the markings on his feathers, white bricks matching his body, and black accents matching his beak, visually sinking completely into his surroundings, while bearing a presence completely opposite to this notion. Upon entering these gates, this envoy demands the four nobles who stand before him to move aside and give him command of the city he rightfully deserves. Once they deny this order, he manages to skillfully defeat them, even claiming the life of one of them, to ascertain his position, solidifying himself as the new ruler of this vast country. This single scene that serves as our first major introduction to the character embodies every allying factor that defines who Lord Shen is within his present. Shen, throughout his entire life, who had been cursed with an appearance akin to the color of death, no matter how much he may visually sink into his scenery, uses every last aspect of his presence to constantly ascertain his precedence and differentiation from everything around him, using said presence to fully extend his physical form and what he deems as obvious brilliance. One of the most selling factors of this uniqueness is his eyes. These eyes, combined with how he so expertly utilizes his physical structure, alongside his glaringly different approach from everyone else in this world, solidify his ideals, demeanor, and effect, both within a meta and narrative sense. Whereas most other prolific characters are substantial, well-bodied fighters, with large striking eyes, loud booming voices, openly triumphant natures, and constant color schemes, Shen is instead defined by a meek and thin body, sharp glaring eyes, a conserved and almost whispering tone of voice, a conniving nature, and a completely diversified color scheme, mostly relying on the thematic colors of black, white, and red, which intrinsically connect him to both the world and his greatest foe. Another factor that helps ally this throughout the films is the image birds have attained for themselves within these films, such as the geese and crane, often having passive, meek, and subservient approaches, being described by their thin features, small presences both emotionally and physically, and their willingness to prioritize others over themselves. Whereas Shen, due to the nature of being a peacock, can appear as both a meek bird, but can also transform into having, just as he has ascertained for himself throughout the story, a larger-than-life presence, by literally spreading his wings to reveal a mirage of striking, colorful feathers. This obsession with priority serves as a large reason that for the majority of the film, he is so often surrounded by countless minions, relying on them to a level more intimate than he probably is even aware of himself. As for one of the first times in his life, he finally has a group that will both follow and prioritize him, though he is not above being apart from them for very key moments of personal conquest, or them just being by his side would lower the impact of his presence, being showcased best in his introductory scenes, where he chooses to walk into the vast gates and challenge the ones who stand behind them, completely solitary. Unlike his faithful minions, though, despite the fact the rulers they once served are now far gone to the existence of death, the major generals still choose to prioritize their word and image over the brilliant image of the deserving monarchs standing directly before them. Triggering Shen to, although he was well versed within the arts of martial arts and kung fu, end them, like all foes most against his psyche and desperations, with his signature cannon. The physical manifestation of the last ounce of control he has to desperately cling to in his life, and the complete and utter antithesis to the entire spiritual core of kung fu. Where kung fu is a complicated, concentrated art of elegant and precise movement within living things, Shen's cannon, fused with his personal stake of his fireworks, is a simple, unrefined envoy of inorganic and chaotic movement within the guise of a mechanical construct, desecrating their prided kung fu to bolster his idea of making sure everything he'd done so far wasn't in complete vain.
You were wrong, Suser. We sail to victory tonight. Your magic panda is clearly a fool.
Are you certain it is the panda who is a fool? You just destroyed your ancestral home, Shen.
A trivial sacrifice, when all of China is my reward.
Then will you finally be satisfied? Will the subjugation of the whole world finally make you feel better?
As a start, I might also convert the basement into a dungeon.
The cup you choose to fill has no bottom. It is time to stop this madness.
Why on earth would I do that?
So your parents can rest in peace.
My parents hated me. Do you understand? They wronged me. And I will make it right.
They loved you. They loved you so much that having to send you away killed them.
The dead exist in the past. And I must attend to the future. Set the Soothsayer free. She's no use to me.
Goodbye, Shen. I wish you happiness.
Happiness must be taken. And I will take mine.
This idea of bolstering one's motivation in order to convince oneself that all they have done so far isn't for nothing fits seamlessly into the constant themes drastically covered in all installments in this trilogy, often being done in response to the expectations handed upon them by the ones they cared for most. Tai Lung's promised dream to become the dragon warrior by Shifu, Shen's promised dreams of becoming the next emperor of China by his parents, and Kai's promised dreams of standing alongside his fellow friend and warrior, Oogway. Though on top of this, Shen receives a second expectation counteracting his first, being the expectation of Soothsayer's fortune, being what pushes him to make his climactic decision of mass genocide, standing as the perfect supplement to all Oogway stood for in the first film, proving multiple of his words of wisdom completely correct, fitting perfectly into the overall desperation of learning to relinquish the necessity and convincing of one's own control. Kung Fu Panda has always revolved around the theme of identity, and this film is absolutely no exception. So far, it's purposely been mentioned very little, but undeniably Shen is most united with the fellow warrior of black and white, Po. Po and Shen are united not just by color and experience, but most powerfully by what led their experiences to their point. Po is one who had his past begin with forced upon atrocity, and Shen a person who had his future defined by self-imposed atrocity. This conviction is what clearly defines them and what serves as their greatest duality and parallel. Throughout these films, Po's identity of being a panda has always been a differentiator and detriment to his life, causing him to often become the target of ridicule and comedy, usually having his weight, lightness, and stupidity targeted. Shen is one of the first major beings who is not simply driven by these similar expressions of prejudice and humor. Although at points, Shen does dip into similar ridicule during his early confrontations with Po, these jabs quickly evaporate and quite hastily become specifically targeted towards Po's makeup and core components. By his intrinsic design, Po's role as the dragon warrior plays absolutely no part in his motivations against him nor his dynamic with him, literally not being mentioned once in the film by his mouth. As opposed to Tai Lung and Kai, who are driven by the resentment towards this title and the concepts of Kung Fu they represent, by nature of this film, prioritizing the introspection of Po's core as a character, relying far more on the idea of who he is on a thematic and personal level, Shen is driven by who Po is, what he looks like, his species, and his own merits. For the first time, Po is judged for simply being him, not for simply being different, but judged for what he is feared to be, instead of being simply ridiculed for it. One of the best showcases of this fear is when Soothsayer reintroduces the prediction of Shen's defeat to Po. In response to this, Shen immediately breaks her bowl, proceeding to specifically use his signature feathers to fan away the latent smoke. This is his last-ditch effort to have a sense of limited control over his circumstance, specifically using his most prideful and controlling feature as the tool to literally disperse the lingering smoke of the fate handed to him yet again. Another example is when at the peak of his fear during one of his confrontations with Po later in the film, during the midst of their heated battle, he randomly lets out a completely undignified peacock squawk, totally counteracting his persona of desperately clinged upon control that he had convinced himself he had become one with for so very long. Through extension of this fear, and the fleeting relations to his troubled past brought about by this fear, Shen spends much of the film, although he could easily kill Po on the spot, attempting to drag Po down to a similar level of emotional solitude, in an attempt to finally not be so alone anymore, by standing somewhat alongside another fellow warrior of black and white. The words he gives Po regarding the nature of the death of his parents and his insistence on convincing Po of the idea that his parents hatefully abandoned him are also clear mirrors to his own broken, twisted perception of the nature of what his parents did to him and what parents truly embody within this world.
How did you? How did you do it?
You know, you just keep your elbows up and keep the shoulders loose.
Not that. How did you find peace? I took away your parents. Everything. I scarred you for life.
See, that's the thing, Shen. Scars heal.
No, they don't. Wounds heal.
Oh, yeah. What do scars do? They fade, I guess?
I don't care what scars do.
You should, Shen. You gotta let go of that stuff from the past, because it just doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is what you choose to be now.
You're right. Then I choose
this!
Despite all these attempts to drag and destroy him, what truly divides Poe and Shen is how they view the validity of scars. What said scars mean, how they can disperse, and how the ones who inflicted said scars upon them should be responded to. Even when Shen is at his lowest low and Poe at his highest high, Poe, despite now being in the perfectly mirrored role to the one he bared earlier, is unable to even contemplate fiery rage and hatred towards the man he now overlooked, simply forgiving him for what he had done, and doing everything imaginable to try and save him from his hatred and pain. Sadly for both, though, this offering of peace would never come to pass. Shen, the insatiable conqueror, the one who viewed the simplicities of peace as things that should be ripped and attained, launches at Poe, attempting to strike him, but ultimately fails, falling truly, in the end, to a warrior of black and white, but nowhere near the warrior he tried to avoid judgment from for so very long. Instead, the warrior that shared his name, scars and feathers. Falling conclusively to his own hand, potentially the only outcome that could bring him any form of anything even close to peace. One often meets his destiny on the road to avoid it.